Hello friends, in this video let us discuss lap winding. So we all know that lap winding is a type of armature winding, and before talking about lap winding in detail, I would like to talk about few basic terms used in this armature winding. So if anyone asks you to define armature winding, then you can say him that armature winding is an arrangement of conductors to develop desired EMF by relative motion in a heteropolar magnetic field. So basically there are two types of machine. One is a heteropolar machine and the other one is a homopolar machine. So in heteropolar machine you will be having the field system consisting of alternate north and south poles. That is, if you are having one north pole, then there will be one south pole, again north pole, again south pole. So we will be having alternate north and south poles in a field system. Then that field system employing machine is your heteropolar machine, and your homopolar machine is where the field system having only one active pole. So that is homopolar machine. So here we shall talk about the few basic terms here. So first let me talk about the conductor. So your conductor is defined as the individual length of wire lying in a magnetic field. So any wire lying in a magnetic field can be termed as a conductor. Now coming to the term. Now if I say there are two conductors, this is one conductor and this is other conductor. There are two conductors. These two conductors are lying in a magnetic field, and now if I connect these two conductors in series, they will form a term such that their resultant EMF will be double that of an individual conductor. That is, if I say there will be 1 volt in this conductor induced and 1 volt induced in this conductor, the resultant EMF will be double, that is 2 volt. So this is your term. Now your coil can be defined as a single turn, or you can say one or more turns connected in series, and their end connection will be connected to the commutator segments. In particular, if I talk about the lap winding, which is a type of armature winding. So this is one turn and their end connection is connected to the commutator segments, or you can say adjacent commutator segments, especially talking about the lap winding. Now you can see here, this is your turn. So this is your turn, and here the dotted portion represents the bottom part of the conductor, and this is the top part of the conductor. And you can see here the commutator, adjacent commutator segments, their end connections are connected here. Or you can say this is the front end connector and this is the back end connector. I will talk about them in later. So this is a turn, and this turn is connected to the commutator segments forming a coil, and the coil can be of one or more turns. So here you can see this is one turn, and this is the other turn, and this is the other turn. So this is a three turn coil, and this is a one turn coil, this is one turn coil, and this is three turn coil. So this is, from here you can differentiate the difference between the turn and coil. So a coil can be of one or many more turns, and a turn will be the two conductors connected in series lying in a magnetic field. Now coil group is, a coil group may have one or more single coils. One or more single coils is termed as the coil group. Now your winding, what is winding? So winding is the number of conductors in a coil group is your winding. Now inductor, so one of the wires forming the coil side. So basically a coil will be having two sides. So this is one coil side and this is the other coil side. Now one of the wires forming the coil side is termed as an inductor in a coil. So that is the inductor. Now the front end connector, so you can see here, this is the front end portion of a coil. So where the front end portion is connected to the commutator segments, this is your, the wire, you can say basically the front end connector is a wire connecting the front portion of a coil to the adjacent commutators. So there is adjacent commutator segments in a lap winding, especially talking about in lap winding. So this is the front end connector, and the back end connector is, so we have talked about, this is an inductor on one side of coil and this is an inductor on other side of coil, where the voltage is induced in this inductor, and this inductor on one side of coil is connected to the inductor on the other side of coil with the help of a wire in the back part, that is back end connector. It is in the back part, so back end connector, it is the front part, so front end connector. So this is back end, front end connector and the back end connector. Now talking about the pole pitch. Pole pitch, there are many definitions of the pole pitch. So here, especially talking in the armature winding, I will define pole pitch as the conductors per pole. So if I say there are 54 conductors per 6 poles. So there will be 6 poles. So conductor 54 conductors in a 6 pole machine, then the pole pitch will be simply 54 by 6, that is 9 conductors per pole. So this is your pole pitch. Pole pitch is the number of conductors per poles. In other way, you can also define it as the angular distance between the center of one pole to the center of other pole in terms of armature conductors. So if you see in the rotor, there will be the slots like this. So there will be one slot like this, other slot, and the slots will be going. And if I say there is one pole here, there is one pole lying here, and let me say this conductor is lying at the center of the pole, and let me say some other pole is lying here. So this is at the center of conductor. So the number of conductors obtained while traveling to the other center of other pole. So from one center to other center you are traveling, and the number of conductors you come across will be nothing but your pole pitch. So here there will be one conductor. If I say this is a single layer winding, that is a single layer winding where will be one conductor in one slot, and there will be, this is the first conductor, second conductor, there is a third conductor. So there will be 3 conductors per pole, you can say as a pole pitch. So this is pole pitch. So simply remember, it is conductor per pole, very easy to remember, or you can say it is the angular distance between the center of 2 adjacent poles. So this is the 2 adjacent poles. Now coming to the back pitch. So your back pitch, I will take this connection here. So your back pitch is also defined as a coil span. Coil span, or you can also call it as coil spread. So it is a distance in terms of armature conductor. It is a distance in terms of armature conductor between the start end of one coil and the finishing end of the same coil. So I'll be talking about this coil. So this is the start end. The starting side of a coil is represented in the solid portion, and the finishing side of coil, or the back side of, or the bottom side of the coil, is represented in a dotted fashion. So if you say there are 2 conductors in a same slot, so let me say here, this is one conductor and this is the other conductor. So where the top conductor is represented by the solid line, and the bottom conductor is represented by the dotted portion. So this is what I am representing here. So this is the top conductor and this is the bottom conductor of the same coil. So if I say there is a one here, and you will be having some slots other way, where your one is the top, then one dash will be at the bottom. So your one dash will be at the bottom. That is what I am represented here. So the distance in terms of armature conductor between the starting side of coil to the finishing side of coil is termed as the back pitch. This is your YB. Now coming to the front pitch. The front pitch is defined as a distance in terms of armature conductor from the finishing side of one coil to the starting side of another coil. So this is your YF. That is the front pitch, and your resultant pitch will be equal to the starting side of one coil to the starting side of the next coil is your resultant pitch. This is YR. So you can see the starting side of one coil and this is the starting side of another coil. So there are 2 coils here, and you can see the front pitch as the finishing side of one coil to the starting side of next coil, and the back pitch, which is also known as the coil span, this is the distance between the starting side of the same coil to the finishing side of the same coil. It is coil span or coil spread, or you can say back pitch. Now talking about the commutator pitch is a distance in terms of commutator segments. Here we are talking in terms of commutator segments. So it is the distance between the end connection of a coil. So here you can see this is one connection here, this is the other connection to the commutator segment. Then the distance, this distance in terms of commutator segment, is your commutator pitch, and this is also your commutator pitch YC. So this is your commutator pitch. Now talking about the full pitch, so here you can see this is the north pole and this is the south pole. So if I say this is the pole pitch, pole pitch is the distance between the center of two poles, as we have talked earlier. So this is your pole pitch. Now your full pitch is that pitch where the coil span will be equal to pole pitch. When the coil span will be equal to pole pitch, then you can say your winding has to be full pitch winding. And the advantage of full pitch winding is you can have the advantage of obtaining the maximum desired EMF. So maximum EMF can be obtained by having full pitch winding. And if the coil span, let me say CS is a coil span, if the coil span is less than the pole pitch, then you will call it as a short pitch. This is a short pitch winding. And if the coil span is greater than the pole pitch, you can call it as the, this is the over pitched winding, over pitched winding. So the advantage of this fractional pitched winding is, there are two advantages of this fractional pitch windings. So one advantage is, if I write here, one advantage is you can have a substantial saving of copper. So if I talk you about your short pitch winding, so there the copper will be of lesser, that means the copper use will be lesser when compared to your full pitch winding. So this is one advantage where you are having substantial, that is enough saving of copper, enough saving of copper. And the other thing is, so if you see this over pitch winding, there will be having lesser mutual inductance. So owing to this lesser mutual inductance between the two coil sides or two inductors of a coil, there will be improved commutation owing to lesser mutual inductance. So these are the advantages of the fractional pitch winding. Now let us proceed to the types of armature winding and then later on talk about the lap winding. So your armature winding are always of non-salient pole type. So basically there are two types of rotor, one is the salient pole type rotor and other one is the non-salient pole type rotor. So in the salient pole type of rotor you are having the projected poles, but in the non-salient pole, non-salient type of rotor you are having the cylindrical in shape with parallel slots. So there won't be any projected poles in the non-salient pole type rotor. So here your armature winding are always of non-salient pole type rotor, and they are usually, the windings are usually distributed symmetrically around the circumference of the armature. So according to the degree of closure, so closure, C-L-O-S-U-R-E, according to the degree of closure, the armature winding are of two types. One is the open coil winding, one is the open coil winding, and the other one is the closed coil winding. So your open coil winding is that winding which does not close on itself. It does not close on itself. So if a conductor has started from here, it won't come to the same position, that is open coil winding. So it does not close on itself, and there will require some external connection to the load or the source. And in the closed coil winding is that winding which closes on itself. It closes on itself, that means once you travel through that path, you will come to the same point from the starting point. If you have started from one point, let me say A, and if you completely trace the path and you will come to the same point, that means the winding gets closed, that is closed coil winding, and another one is the open coil winding. So basically open coil winding are never employed in your DC machines, and only closed coil windings are employed in the DC machines because to facilitate the commutation of the coil. So here commutation of the coil is required. So as a, to facilitate the commutation of the coil, we are employing the closed coil windings only in the DC machine, whereas you can employ both closed coil as well as open coil in the AC machines. So again, your closed coil can be of two types. One is the Grammy ring type. It is a Grammy ring type winding, and the other one is the drum type winding. Other one is a drum type winding. So Grammy ring type is the earlier winding, and it has been successfully replaced by the drum type winding. And this drum type winding basically has two advantages. So one advantage is most of the copper conductor, except the end connections will be active, that is active in generating EMF. So that is the one advantage of the drum type winding. The other advantage is the coils can be preformed. So before placing in the slots of the armature, you can preform the coils and you can insulate them, and later on you can place in the armature. So it avoids lot of labor cost. So you can say cost can be saved by employing this drum type of winding. And again, your drum type of winding, it can be of single layer or the double layer. Mostly we are using double layer, where the coils can be preformed and insulated before placing the slots. And due to economic reason also, we say double layer winding is preferred in a drum type winding. And these drum type winding are basically of again three types. One is a lap winding, and the other one is a wave winding, and other one is a frog leg winding. So we are not talking about the frog leg winding here, which is the combination of the lap winding as well as a wave winding. So in this video, I will talk about only the lap winding, and later on I will discuss a problem on the lap winding, and later on I will take a wave winding. So if I talk about the lap winding, in the lap winding, so basically this is the connection of a lap winding. So this is your lap winding. In a lap winding, what you can see is this is the starting side of a coil and this is the finishing side of a coil. So the finishing side of a coil, so this is the finishing side of a coil, is connected to a commutator segment, and same this finishing coil or finishing side of coil is connected to the starting side of the next coil. So this is connected to the starting side of the next coil, and here you can see there will be overlap between the successive coils. So this part is the overlap between the two coils, and as there is overlap, these type of winding is referred as a lap winding. So simply you can define lap winding where the finished side of one coil is connected to the starting side of one coil, that is the starting side of next coil, as well as it is connected to the commutator segments. So this is the lap winding, and basically you will be having lap winding of simplex type, duplex type and the triplex type. So if I talk about the simplex winding, so in the simplex winding, it is only one winding. So in the simplex winding, the number of parallel paths or the parallel circuit will be equal to number of poles. This is simplex winding. Now talking about the duplex winding, duplex winding is comprised of two similar simplex windings. It is comprised of two similar simplex winding, and they are placed in alternate slots. That means every second slot they are placed, and they are connected to alternate commutator segments, alternate slots as well as alternate commutator segments. So that means every second slot they are placed, and every second commutator segment they are connected, not the first one. Suppose if I say there is a one slot here, or there is a one connection here, then leaving this connection there will be other connection here. So that is the alternate commutator segments, as well as similarly is a one slot, then leaving this slot there is another slot. This is, these two are alternate. So they are placed in alternate slots, and they are connected to alternative commutator segments, and the number of parallel paths here will be equal to the twice of number of poles. So this is a duplex winding. Now talking about the triplex winding, we are having three similar simplex winding here. So every third slot of armature is occupied here, and it is connected to every third commutator segment. So just like in the duplex, every second is occupied and connected to every second commutator segment. Here every third commutator, or that is every third armature slot, is occupied and it is connected to every third commutator segment. And here the number of parallel paths will be equal to 3 times of number of poles. So as you can see, the parallel paths will be increasing as you employ more and more simplex windings. So these winding can also be called as a multiple or parallel winding. Now let us talk few important points regarding this lap winding. So here I will talk about the important points one by one. So the first point is your back pitch must be approximately equal to the pole pitch, which is given by the number of conductors per poles. So the second point is your back pitch will be always greater or lesser than the front pitch by a value 2m, where m is the multiplicity of the winding. That is, your back pitch will be equal to front pitch plus or minus 2m, where m is equal to 1 for the simplex winding, 2 for the duplex and 3 for the triplex. Now when yb is greater than yf, your lap winding is called as a progressive lap winding, and when yb is less than yf, it is called as retrogressive lap winding. So here you can see this is your progressive lap winding. When you see from left to right, your winding progresses forward. Now, to make this connection as a retroversive, what you do here is you connect this end to this end. So when you connect like this, your YB will be less than YF, and the winding can be called as a retroversive winding. And the third point is, that is, when you travel from right to left, the winding seems to be progressive this direction. For the retrogressive, for the progressive, the winding seems to progress this direction. So the third point is, your back pitch and front pitch must be odd. They must be odd number. And fourth point is, your average pitch, which is given by the average of YB plus YF by 2, and this should be equal to the pole pitch, that is the Z per T. And the fifth point is, your resultant pitch is always even. So being the difference of YB and YF, it will be always even, because these two quantities are odd and the difference of odd will be even. So your YR will be even and it will be equal to 2M, where M is the multiplicity of the winding, where M is equal to 1, 2, 3 for the simplex, duplex and triplex, and for 4 for the quadruplex winding respectively. So this is fifth point. And the sixth point is, your commutator pitch YC will be equal to simply M. So where M equal to 1 for simplex, 2 for duplex and 3 for the triplex. So here in the duplex, triplex, what I want to say here is, so you will be having some poles like this here, poles, and you will be having slots. So if you have placed, let me say connector 1 is here in the simplex, I am talking about a simplex winding, then your connector 2 will be here in the simplex winding, and similarly 3. But in the duplex winding, your second connector will be at this point. So it is in the alternate slot, the connectors will be placed in the alternate slot, again the third connector will be here. This is in the duplex winding, and in the triplex winding, there will be any connector here, and there will be connector at this junction. So this is the second connector. So 1, 2, 3, though every third slot the connector is placed, and this connected to the every third segment. So that is in the triplex winding. So your YC will be equal to M, M is equal to 1 for the, so M is equal to 1, M is equal to 1 for the simplex, and if you connect the end here, this will be, the segment distance will be 2 here, and it will be 3 for the triplex winding. And the seventh point is, the number of parallel paths will be, number of parallel paths will be equal to M into P, where M is equal to 1 for the simplex, 2 for the duplex, 3 for the triplex. Now there is another important concept in the lap winding, that is the equalizer connection. So equalizer connection. So as the video is going lengthy, I am speaking very fast. So you can reduce the speed of the your play speed, you can reduce the play speed to listen very carefully. So because this is a boring concept, I know, in a DC machine, still I am making it easy for you understand it well. So equalizer connection. In the lap winding, despite of best efforts, you make every parallel path under the same pole. So there is a, under the one pole pair, where the induced EMF to be equal, and when the induced EMF in every parallel path will be equal, then the current through that every parallel path will be equal. So in spite of the best efforts, there won't be equal induced EMF in all the parallel paths. So as a result, what you see is, there is a difference in the induced EMF in several parallel paths, and due to this difference, there will be circulating currents formed. Now these circulating currents will cause two adverse effects. One is the heating of the armature, and the heating is more than the heating caused by the full load armature current. And the second disadvantage is, this will cause the sparking at the commutator segments and the brushes. So there will be more wear and tear of your brushes. So this is the second disadvantage, and it has to be avoided by using this equalizer connection. So basically, your equalizer connections, or equalizer connection is nothing but, it is a low resistance, it's a low resistance copper ring, or you can say copper wire. So this equalizer is connected at such points where the potential has to be made equal. So your lab winding employs this equalizer connection to make the induced EMF in every parallel path equal, so that there won't be any circulating currents due to that different induced EMF in different parallel paths. So basically you are employing this simple, that is a duplex and the triplex winding. Basically the sole purpose is to carry the large current. So to carry the large current at low voltage. So for the parallel paths, the voltage should be equal for each path. So as you are having more parallel paths, you can carry the more, or you can say there will be large amount of current can be carried, and at the same time the current carried by each conductor in the parallel paths will be reduced. Now this reduced current will help in having a good commutation with, or you can say it will help you in having a sparkless commutation. So in the next video I will take a problem on this lab winding, and I'll finish it, and later on I will proceed with the wave winding. So this is all about the lab winding. I hope you understood well. Please subscribe to our channel. Thank you.